We have a panel discussion after this on convergence of IoT, that's Internet of Things, and data science. The eminent speakers are Sri Gautam Banerjee, founder president of Data Science Foundation, and Sri Shantanu Shom, director of Shom Imaging Informatics Private Limited. Mr. Banerjee, Mr. Shom, please. For the moderating the session, I would request Mr. Rupam Chaudhary, regional head of NASCOM, to help us out. Mr. Nirupam Chaudhary is Regional Director of NASCOM Eastern Region in India. He has 2 decades of experience in information technology and related market intelligence. He has extensively worked on new product ideas, business planning, management development, and major implementations. Nirupam has worked with companies like IDC, TCS, and AMI partners in the past. He has done B.Tech Electronics and Instrumentation from Jadavpur University before his MBA in Information Systems.
Thank you.
I will request our senior member, executive committee member, Mr. Jonathan Yearley, to please felicitate the speakers.
It should not be correct to start and dive into the discussions right away, but rather give an analogy, right? Talking from today's context, suppose we have a conference starting at 10:30. So if it is possible for Inari and her team to basically switch on the AC machines of this room maybe 45 minutes before, so that you could start the session sharp at 10:30 without inconvenience of the guys who are attending it, is basically an example of IoT, right? With all the equipment and devices are on net, could be connected and could be given instructions by which they can operate. Second example is something very, very practical right now. Data science. Data science, as an example, it should be it actually gaining intelligence and information about structured and unstructured data. And this is the science of getting that intelligence out. So a very practical example could be like if there is a session going to start at 1 and we are between lunch, and across there are 1,700 which has happened in India in last 5 years, what is the kind of attention span that attendees would have if we are not restricting ourselves to straight discussions? I think this could be some sort of analytics or data science which you can drive out of that. So very, very practical example. So before what I'm trying to do is we have just sharp 15 to 20 minutes which Inagi mentioned to us. So we keep it very sharp and short and crisp. There are some questions, of course, I didn't initially thought that we'd give it out to you so you can ask questions to our panelists. Both Shantanu Shom is the CEO of Somnetics, is a very, very, I'm also Gautam Da from CEO of Business Bravo. very eminent and seasoned professionals in their fields, known to almost many of you, but of course, I think today's discussion will actually limit us to go much beyond that. So, I let me work a particular situation for you and say how India is ready for it as yet. Think of a morning, and it's from an analogy from a famous book, I think last year. Think of a scenario where basically early in the morning at 6 a.m. to be safe, you are actually awake, and you were awake by the smell of freshly brewed coffee. You were not using the alarm clock, but actually the curtains automatically are shifting apart so that the sunlight comes into the room. You are actually, instead of alarm, in the bed there are some sensors, of course, and the bed is actually vibrating so that you automatically wake up, because it understands your REM cycle. It understands how much you have slept in the night and what you have slept very late or not. It gets all the information out. So, how are we ready for such kind of scenario, which is classic in the marriage of the IoT and the data science environment? Are you ready for such a scenario as it? We started with Gautam.
Yeah, I think the state and simple answer is no. So, I think we are not yet ready for that kind of a scenario, and still not sure actually whether that kind of a scenario will be helpful. Even in near future, I am not getting a distant future. However, I think a lot of other simple things can definitely be done with IoT. And having said that, let us always take technology with not a pinch of salt, but a lump or a bucket of salt. So that technology is not defeating us, right? Having said that, I believe that we will discuss a couple of cases where IoT as well as data science can help businesses, public infrastructure projects, governance, and even for social good within itself. Right? So that's my take.
What about proper? I mean, okay. Before coming to industrial applications, go to show you and tell us in the field of IoT, especially talking about Indian cases, right? Because we don't want to touch many global cases. We are not that level as yet. But how do we have some brilliant gentlemen in this room who are championing their own fields, their own industries, like retail and small manufacturing, and other focus verticals like even agriculture in technology. Right? How are you ready for that as yet, and how practically is it implementable?
See, in my view, any IoT application, IoT is not doing anything new. It is actually facilitating something what has already been done. And it is doing, solving cases or solving problems in a different way. But it is not doing anything new, right? You tend to wake up in the morning, there is nothing new, right? And in my opinion, IoT should be kind of problem driven. When the problem is asking for a solution, and you should, try to mitigate the problem or mitigate this particular risk in a different way, but mitigation is required. And IoT can definitely, in the last 5 or 6 seminars across India, I've always, heard the examples of the smart coffee maker and the smart toaster. But IoT can go far beyond that. It can, it can develop smart cities, smart agriculture, smart environmental applications. And I personally believe that the best way of IoT applications can be, you can see in protection of environment, pollution management, and health and safety.
Absolutely. So there are areas where it touches us personally as individual consumers, and there are industrial cases where there are solutions available with solution providers.
Absolutely.
Who could implement the basic problem statements which are in question. Gautam, in terms of go to industrial applications of some of the data that trillions and trillions and petabytes of data which are being generated out of smaller even in traffic lights in scenario, the video surveillance, there are so much of data being generated. How are you actually practically going to use that? And what could be some of the applications of data science in today's scenario, especially talking about in our industries which are there in states like that of ours?
Right. So I think that's a big opportunity nonetheless. So let's talk about, you know, specific cases, otherwise, you know, we'll become critical. So let's take about the retails, right? I mean, when I say retail, it can be a Big Bazaar, or Spencer's, or even Anjali Jewelers, or PC Chandra, or even Imami, or, Frank Cross, like all are retail mode, right? So I think one of the biggest opportunities here is basically that India has never been able to actually encash on something called a customer loyalty. So here, whenever you get into either a Spencer's or a Shopper Stop or Frank Ross or anywhere else, all that we get to see is basically direct, common, for the mass discounts. So 40% discount on this, and at the most maximum, a bit of market basket analysis is done saying that if you buy X, you will get 25% discount on Y. The market, the business, is actually big time losing on revenue generation. You are actually giving a discount en masse without considering a portion of the consumers who will actually any which way buy by giving that, even not availing that 40% discount. So you are losing the money. And then you are actually not able to focus to someone else who could have actually bought it just for 25% discount. And that is something that is unfortunately not happening in spite of the loyalty cards, because we are not investing in data science. You go to Macy's, you go to Walmart's of the world, you go to Aldi's, Sainsbury in UK and anywhere else for that matter, you actually never get to see an en masse discount written anywhere in the lobbies of the departmental stores. It always comes as either an SMS or an email, which is very customized. What you do is basically ensure that you maximize your revenue and you give the minimum discount to the customers who will actually go for it. Right? And we have never done it. I mean, all of us, we may have some cards here and there, but all you get to see is that if you are a gold customer, a gold member of Shopper Stop, it's like valid for everyone else. That means it is not analyzing what kind of clothes you're buying. It's not analyzing saying that I actually buy only certain kinds of purses or ladies' bags, and hence I may be fond of getting a kind of a footwear which is of high quality leather. So I need not get discounts for something else. It has to be customized. So that is a big opportunity, whether it's medical stores like Frank Cross and others, which is there. On the other side, talk about transportation sector. So any heavy industry, whether it's logistics, chemicals, fertilizers, or any kind of patent tanks and all that, any kind of common engineering products has to be shipped. Now, obviously we're expecting all changes with the GST where the trucks need not be solved everywhere and all that. But however, there's a lot of logistical problems, faced with, all this transportation. So simple IoT devices can actually help us plan it, better contingencies and traction, including any kind of intervention that may be needed because of accidents and all that. At least with an efficiency which is 10 times more than what we see. So these are the two things,
Exactly. So, either it be management or be it supply chain or be it efficiency enhancement through the devices which are in spot. Right from morning, we have been having two brilliant sessions where we got enough, I think, we got a dosage of what to do and not to do in the cyberspace. And I cannot, but still I cannot, I cannot resist but ask this question to you, Abdullah. We know that with Internet of Things and Internet of Everything, and it's a connected world and driverless cars in place, there's so much of problems of also which could come in, right? So what sort of steps should be taken, what sort of process should be followed so that it's not, security is properly maintained and the consumers or the industry should not suffer? What is your take on that and process forward?
See, IoT security is security and security policies are paramount, which is very important because a good hacker can have all the endpoints and all the sensors, and you can feed with the wrong data actually, and it can actually make the system absolutely go haywire. Some of these are in case of smart grid. Suppose if you the frequency measurement device, if you can feed it with the wrong frequency, the entire grid will actually go out of operation, whereas there is no problem. I mean, this can be done actually, you know. I mean, during
so what are the best practices? What should be done?
A lot of, you know, new, I mean, this is actually something evolving actually. The endpoint security, cloud server security, radio network security, all these things are evolving. IEEE is working on this. They are actually, you know, bringing out security standards. There are securities right now, but I must say the securities and other things are not matured enough.
So I think we will pause here because we have about 5-6 minutes left. Before I pose any more questions to the panelists, let me pause here and see if there is a show of hand. Is there an industry question they would want, you want to ask from the audience here? Because we have questions, time for a couple of questions from your side. That could be interesting. Anybody?
It's not an industrial question, but I have a question for the panelists here. So I have a question for the panelists here. This goes back to the conversation that's taking place before. The service providers, and when I'm talking about mobiles being hacked, I was not aware that a mobile can be hacked, and I'm actually surprised on this issue. So that's why one of the reasons why I have this question to you. The service provider gives or sells your mobile number to somebody else where you get random advertisements or messages on your mobile. Don't you think if a mobile can be hacked, that is the first thing that should be stopped? And what are we doing about it?
Can I take it? Okay, so I think a very relevant and a good question which everyone has raised here today. Sir, so first is that the outcome that you mentioned, the SMSs are coming or you get to see advertisements, that is not an outcome of hacking. So let's clarify. So it's not an outcome of hacking. What is happening is that or neither it's outcome of the hacking, neither it's like the provider is actually passing on the cell numbers to anyone else. That is there, that's a different issue. But let me tell you why you are getting that. So what is happening is that, talk about Reliance Jio. So what's the revenue model? Any guess? How come it's giving us free? 300 rupees you're giving and then it's giving you free plus 3 months of service. Do you think he's doing a charity? Leave apart the point that we may have all in our mind saying that, no, so baad mein wo aise charge karega. That he'll never able to do in Indian market. So we'll again switch back, right? So what is a revenue model? So his revenue model actually goes, as an answer to his question, which is that Reliance is tracking the individual behavior, right? So if I'm searching for a tablet, and I may select or like maybe a Lenovo or something else, I will start getting ads from Micromax saying that I've got these tablets as well, right? And what is happening is that it can, go back to a company like a Ford or a Maruti or a Toyota saying that you are spending 5 lakhs for a full page ad one day. Correct? You give me 5 lakhs and I'm going to hit the customers so strongly that the strike rate, that means, against which they are actually going to buy or solicit inquiry, that's going to be as high as 30%. How? Because he knows that out of so many guys, 72 million customers, how many of these customers in the age bracket of 30 to 35 are actually browsing new cars? That too with a special category, because you always write in the Google saying that write cars, you write SUV 7-seater, you write this and that, right? You say SUV with 5 or 6 airbags. So it is actually so directed and so it funnels down the customer base. And that's where Reliance actually, even if it's going to charge, 5 paisa per customer and it shoots it out to, out of 72 million, 5 million, do you understand how much money it can make? So that is what is happening in this case. Just to clarify, I'm hacking, I'm passing on the numbers, and what happens is it is never done by the service providers. Unfortunately, what Sanjeev was saying, or I think Mr. Vivas was saying, that is done by some unscrupulous, unethical employees working there, who will pass on the database for someone.
No, basically what I was trying to say is, because of these numbers, the service provider is giving you the numbers other than for yourself, the people who are actually working on there, they automatically get your number. So can that be traced back to hack your mobile?
It can be traced back if hacking happens, but as I said, that really happened. It's basically some unethical employee sitting out there who has got access, and for some illegal transactions, they actually sell the data. Right.
There are special numbers, like VIPs are special numbers which don't have access to. There are ways to prevent that. I think it's fine. So is there any other question, or by as I promised, we'll end with a short 3 minutes video which talks about cases which each one of you can relate to, as Shantanu promised.
It is kind of a before and after situation.
Okay.
What used to be, you know, how industry used to work when IoT is not in picture, and what can happen when, you know, IoT is in picture.
Sure.
It's a very short video.
That's
very interesting.
Short 3 minute video, and we'll end with that. Thank you everyone for your patience, and take questions often. Thank you so much. Thank you, my panelists.
Thank you, Nirupam. Thank you, Gautam and Shantanu. In IoT and data science, that seems to be the life-changing factors that's catching up momentum and is going to very soon change our lives, but not before we have our lunch. We are all hungry. Let's have lunch and then again start thinking about data science and IoTs and cybersecurity and all that. Friends, the lunch is ready.